sedentary lifestyles and obesity has led to a remarkable elevation in the number of people suffering from diabetes. As the International Diabetes Federation, IDF, has rightly quoted, "Looks like diabetes is indeed one of the most challenging health problems in the 21st century. This global epidemic is not only a major cause for kidney failure, lower limb amputations, and new cases of blindness each year, but it's also a leading cause for heart disease and stroke. In almost every country in this world, this global epidemic serves as a serious threat for the health of the population. The IDF has ranked China with 90 million cases and India with 61 million cases in 2011, with the highest number of patients diagnosed with diabetes. The numbers are predicted to go up to 129 million in China and 101 million in India in 2030. China and India are followed by the United States, Russia, Brazil, Mexico, Bangladesh, Egypt, Indonesia, and Pakistan as the top 10 countries with the highest number of people suffering from diabetes in 2011. Diabetes led to about 4.8 million deaths in 2012. This contributed to about 8.3% of the total world mortality. There were 366 million people suffering from diabetes in 2011, and this number was predicted to go up to 552 million in 2030. The United States has been ranked, and the diabetes is the seventh major cause of death in this country. There are about 80 million people suffering from pre-diabetes in the United States. As this map indicates, various states, including Alabama, Mississippi, Florida, South and North Carolina, and many other states in the southeastern parts, have been ranked higher with the number of people diagnosed with diabetes. Alabama is ranked second, right after Mississippi, with the highest number of people suffering from diabetes. About 11% of the population in Alabama have been diagnosed with diabetes. This rank corresponds to the high rates of obesity in the state. About 33% of the population in Alabama are obese. Coming to the classification of diabetes, according to the World Health Organization, there is, of course, the type 1 diabetes, which is much less common when compared to the type 2 form. This form, as we all know, is due to the autoimmune destruction of the beta cells in the islets of Langerhans in the pancreas. That destruction is what is causing an absolute deficiency in insulin. There is also a type 2 diabetic form, which affects about 90 to 95% of the population in the US. This form not only is characterized by an insulin resistance, wherein the body does not respond appropriately to the insulin levels, but there is also an insulin deficiency. This is what is contributing to an ineffective insulin state in type 2 diabetes. There is also another form of diabetes, which is the gestational diabetes. This form is diagnosed among pregnant women. After about 10 to 20 years after being diagnosed with GD, the women have about a 50% chance of developing type 2 diabetes. About 2 to 10% of all pregnant women in the US suffer from gestational diabetes. There is also another condition which is a pre-diabetic state, and that precedes type 2 diabetes. This form is termed as an impaired glucose tolerance, and as I mentioned before, about 79 million people in the US are said to be in pre-diabetic condition. Moving on to the molecular aspects of the insulin signal transduction, there are three chief pathways, namely the IRS1, PI3 kinase pathway, the MAP kinase pathway, and the Cbl-CAP pathway. While the first and the third pathway are said to operate in parallel with each other, contributing to various metabolic processes, the mitogen-activated protein kinase pathway is chiefly involved in cell survival, gene transcription, as well as various mitogenic processes. The insulin receptor substrate 1, or the phosphoinositol 3 kinase pathway, is the main focus of our research, and the insulin molecule initially docks onto the insulin receptor. This binding causes tyrosine phosphorylation in the insulin receptor, further leading to the activation of different downstream proteins. Among all these downstream proteins, the insulin receptor substrate 1 serves as a model for the IRS class of proteins. Once the IRS1 is activated, it binds to the P85 regulatory subunit of the PI3 kinase. This binding activates PI3 kinase, leading to the conversion of PIP2 to PIP3. This conversion of phosphoinositol bisphosphate to phosphoinositol trisphosphate leads to the activation of PDK1. PDK1 is nothing but the PI3 kinase dependent serine or threonine kinase. So once PDK1 is activated, AKT gets phosphorylated in its threonine and serine residues, leading to its activation. AKT activation in turn inhibits glycogen synthase kinase 3. Thus, glycogen synthase is activated, contributing to the glycogen synthesis process to begin. This pathway is said to operate in parallel with the Cbl-CAP pathway, as AKT has also been attributed to GLUT4 translocation from the cytoplasm to the plasma membrane, thus leading to glucose uptake. As I mentioned before, insulin receptor is the first protein on which insulin docks in order to affect its various activation effects. The insulin receptor is from the insulin receptor gene in the chromosome 90, and it has about 150 kilobases with 22 exons and 21 introns. There are two alpha subunits and two beta subunits in the insulin receptor. Various covalent disulfide bonds link these subunits in order to form the alpha-2, beta-2 hollow receptor. As soon as the insulin molecule binds to the alpha subunit of the insulin receptor, conformational changes take place in these receptors. These changes in turn lead to the tyrosine phosphorylation of the beta subunit. Thus, various downstream components are in turn phosphorylated and activated. As I mentioned before, the insulin receptor substrate 1 has been a chief focus of many different research groups. This is because of the central role of IRS1 in the entire insulin signaling pathway. looking into the domain structure of IRS1, there is a plexrin homology domain with the phosphotyrosine binding site. This plexrin homology domain has been found to interact directly with the NPX5 motif of the beta subunit of the insulin receptor that we just discussed before. So, there is a direct interaction between IRS1 and the insulin receptor through the phosphotyrosine binding site. Other than the plexrin homology domain, there are about 18 important tyrosine residues in IRS1. These are what are important in the binding of various proteins such as the P85 regulatory subunit of PI3 kinase, GRB2, SHP2, FYN and NIC, all of which contain the SH2 domain. So, our lab has demonstrated through a manuscript published in the Journal of Biological Chemistry that similar to the interaction of IRS1 with the P85 regulatory subunit of PI3 kinase, IRS1 is also able to interact with another player called P62. P62 has a ubiquitin-like domain. This includes an SH2 domain and an AID region. The SH2 domain of P62 interacts directly with the YMXM motif of the IRS1 protein, which we just discussed before. The acidic interaction domain is what is involved in the interaction of P62 with different atypical protein kinases. Other than the zinc finger domain, there is a TRAF6 binding domain for the direct binding of TRAF6, which has a ring finger domain in it. There are also two peptide sequences which are rich in prolin, glutamic acid, serine and threonine residues. These PEST sequences serve as a signal for various proteasomal degradation processes. LC3 interacting region binds to LC3, helping P62 to act as a marker in autophagy. There is also a UBA domain, which is the ubiquitin associated domain. This shuttles different mono and polyubiquitination substrates for degradation. Different studies in P62 knockout mice have not only shown the onset of mature onset obesity, but have also led to the development of insulin and leptin resistance, contributing to the development of type 2 diabetes. Cytoplasmic aggregates such as the Lewy bodies, Mallory bodies, neurofibrillary tangles have all been found to contain rich quantities of P62. Thus, P62 plays a key role in different diseases including Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease and Pagan's disease of the bone, and that signifies the importance of P62 as a scaffolding, shuttling protein. P62 has also been shown to have a direct effect on the E3 ubiquitination ligase activity of TRAF6. Thus, P62 is able to not only cause polyubiquitination of TRAF6, but also has been found to lead to the polymerization and the oligomerization of TRAF6. As different groups demonstrated the direct effect of P62 on the ligase activity of TRAF6, we also intended to analyze the role of TRAF6 and whether it played a unique role in the insulin signaling pathway. Looking into the domain structure of TRAF6, it has a recently identified new gene or the ring finger domain. This ring finger region has been found to be important for the E3 ubiquitinase ligase activity of TRAF6. There are also 5 zinc finger regions from Z1 to Z5 in the N-terminal region. Other than the coiled coil, which has a single alpha stand, there is also a TRAF-C domain, which has a beta sandwich structure in the C-terminal region. TRAF-6, owing to the E3 ubiquitinase ligase activity, which I just discussed before, is also able to affect the ubiquitination and the phosphorylation of AKT. TRAF-6 has also been shown, because of this phosphorylatory effect, moving AKT from the cytoplasm to the membrane. TRAF-6 knockout mice have displayed an impairment in not just the osteoclast development, but also in osteoblast functioning. TRAF-6 has been shown to be involved in inflammatory as well as tumorogenesis processes and serves as a molecular connection between innate immunity and adaptive immunity. So now that its various studies have shown the direct interaction of TRAF-6 in AKT and the effect of the TRAF-6 E3 ligase activity on TRAF-6 on AKT, we wanted to see the involvement of AKT in the insulin signaling process. So we're looking into the domain structure of AKT. There is a plextin homology domain, other than a catalytic kinase domain and a regulatory region. There are 3 important isoforms of AKT, namely AKT1, which is predominantly found in most of the tissues, while AKT2 is chiefly found in skeletal muscle cells, adipose tissue, and also in the liver. AKT3 is chiefly found in the brain as well as the testis. These 2 residues, the threonine-308 and the serine-473, are found to be crucial for the phosphorylation of AKT by PDK1, and this phosphorylation in these 2 residues is what is important for the activation of AKT. So now that we have given an introduction about each of these proteins that we have included in our research, we would move on to the overall goal of this project. So our idea was to see if there was an interaction between these 4 proteins that I just discussed about, namely IRS1, P62, TRAF6, and AKT. As I mentioned before, our lab has demonstrated in JBC that the SH2 subunit of P62 interacts directly with the YM-XM motif of IRS1. Thus, these 2 proteins have been shown to be involved in the insulin signaling pathway. Our lab was the first of its kind to stress upon the importance of P62 in the entire insulin signaling pathway. P62 has been shown to have a direct effect on the E3 ubiquitinase ligase activity, as I mentioned before. Thus, P62 is involved in the polyubiquitination and the oligomerization of TRAF6. Other study published by Yang et al. In Science has also shown that TRAF6, owing to its E3 ligase activity, is able to phosphorylate ubiquitinate AKT. Due to this property, and because of the activation of AKT by phosphorylation, AKT in turn is able to affect its GLUT4 properties as well as is involved in glucose uptake. We also wanted to confirm that P62 and TRAF6 are indeed vital players in the insulin signaling pathway, and these 2 proteins are the connecting bridge between the IRS1 and AKT proteins. So looking into the specific aims of the project, first, we intended to examine the interaction of TRAF6 with both IRS1 and AKT upon insulin stimulation. We wanted to understand how important P62 as well as TRAF6 were in order to AKT to get phosphorylated, in turn leading to its activation, and the important role of TRAF6 as a player to link the downstream AKT protein with the upstream P62 as well as IRS1 proteins. So to begin with the first experiment which I performed, we wanted to see how, if there was a role of TRAF6 in interacting with IRS1 and AKT upon insulin stimulation. For this study, we used L6 myotubules which are obtained from the skeletal muscle of mice. These mimic human skeletal muscle cells, and they were stimulated with or without insulin, serum starved for 4 hours, followed by the lysis of these cells. Immunoprecipitation was performed using TRAF6 antibody, and immunoblotting was performed in order to identify and examine the expression of IRS1 protein as well as the AKT protein using IRS1 and AKT antibodies. The input involved the loading of crude lysates in order to confirm the expression of these proteins in the endogenous L6 myotubule cells. So these results confirmed that TRAF6 interacted with IRS1 as well as AKT only upon insulin stimulation. So we wanted to go ahead and look specifically into the interaction of TRAF6 and IRS1 and confirm the results which we just saw before. Now we have used a completely different cell lines. These are the CHO IR cells, which are Chinese hamster ovarian cells, which were overexpressed with the insulin receptor. After stimulating them with or without insulin, various tagged constructs such as the V5 IRS1 and flat TRAF6 were transfected into these cells. Immunoprecipitation was performed with V5 antibody, and immunoblotting was performed using V5 antibody as well as the Octa antibody. V5 antibody detects the expression of IRS1, as V5 is the tag for IRS1. Octa is the antibody which detects the flag epitope. Thus, by using an immunoblot of Octa antibody, we are able to examine the expression of TRAF6 in these cells. These results confirmed our previous experiment that the interaction of IRS1 with TRAF6 was indeed dependent upon insulin stimulation. Just like how we specifically looked into the interaction between TRAF6 and IRS1, we move on to look into another transfection experiment in order to understand the specific interaction between AKT and TRAF6. So here we have used a similar setup, and CHO IR cells were transfected with different tagged constructs, namely the MYC-AKT and the flat TRAF6. After stimulating these cells with or without insulin, the insulin concentration was the same as the previous experiments. It was 100 nanomolars, treated at 37 degrees Celsius for 15 minutes, and immunoprecipitation was performed using MYC antibody. Octa as well as MYC antibody were used in order to examine the expression of TRAF6 as well as AKT. Again, crude lysates are loaded as the input in order to examine the presence and to confirm that the transfection has been successful. These results show that AKT interacts with TRAF6 upon insulin stimulation. Thus, by conducting 3 different experiments and 2 different cell lines, we can confirm that TRAF6 interacts with IRS1 and AKT upon insulin stimulation. Now that we can confirm TRAF6 indeed interacts with these 2 proteins, we wanted to put P62 into the picture as well. We used the same L6 myotubules for studying the interaction of P62 with the other 3 proteins. Here, the immunoprecipitation has been done using the P62 protein, and immunoblotting was done to see the expression of IRS1, TRAF6, AKT. P62 expression was also analyzed as a control. So these results show that P62 interacts with IRS1, TRAF6 and AKT upon insulin stimulation. So now we wanted to confirm that there was indeed an interaction between P62 and AKT. Again, our lab is the first to show that P62 can be brought into the insulin signaling pathway and to study the interaction between these 2 proteins. In this experiment, we have used CHO IR cells, transfected them with various stacked constructs such as MYC-AKT and HAP62. Immunoprecipitation was done using MYC antibody, and immunoblotting was performed using HA and MYC antibody. So these results confirm the previous experiment that AKT interacts with P62 upon insulin stimulation. Thus, by these experiments, we can conclude that P62 interacts with all the other 3 proteins under study upon insulin stimulation. Now that we have got P62 in the picture, we wanted to move deep in and understand the nature of these interactions. So we wanted to see if TRAF6 was a player in between these 2 proteins, and if TRAF6 was essential for this interaction between P62 and AKT to take place. For this, we used a totally different cell line, which is the wild type and TRAF6 knockout mouse embryonic fibroblast cells. So let me just give a brief introduction about the mouse embryonic fibroblast cells. Male and female mice are allowed to mate, and after checking the success of the mating, during the 13th day of gestation, the embryo of the fetus is harvested and the cells are minced to get the desired mouse embryonic fibroblast cells. So immunoprecipitation was done to understand the interaction of AKT, and we detected TRAF6 and P62 interaction by immunoblotting it with these 2 antibodies. AKT was used as a control in order to compare all the other proteins. So looking into the results, it was understood that the interaction of AKT with P62 was taking place upon insulin stimulation in the wild-type mouse embryonic fibroblast cells. The interaction of AKT with P62 was significantly impaired and was almost absent in the TRAF6 knockout mouse embryonic cells. So these results confirm that TRAF6 was essential for the interaction of AKT with P62. In other words, the interaction of P62 with AKT takes place through TRAF6. Thus, TRAF6 connects P62 with AKT. Now that we have looked into the downstream 3 important proteins, we wanted to go further upstream and see if the interaction of IRS1 and TRAF6 was direct, or if P62 was essential for this interaction to take place. when we used the CHO IR cells and transfected it using different TAT constructs. Here we have used V5IRS1, FlatTRAF6, MYC-P62 for overexpressing the P62 in these cells, and antisense P62 for reducing the expression of the endogenous P62. Immunoprecipitation was performed to detect IRS1, and immunoblotting was performed to examine IRS1 as well as TRAF6. So these results indicate that the interaction of IRS1 with TRAF6 was dependent upon the presence of P62. This is because the interaction of IRS1 with TRAF6 was significantly increased upon the overexpression of P62. On the other hand, the interaction of IRS1 with TRAF6 was significantly impaired when the expression of P62 is reduced in these cells. Thus, P62 is essential for the interaction of IRS1 with TRAF6. Or in other words, the interaction of IRS1 with TRAF6 is dependent upon and takes place through P62. Now that we have understood that P62 is present between IRS1 and TRAF6, and TRAF6 is present in between P62 and AKT, we wanted to see the overall picture and how the reduction of P62 levels in these cells would affect this other proteins. CHO IR cells were transfected with the antisense P62. This transfection in turn reduces the expression of the endogenous P62 in these cells. Upon insulin stimulation, immunoprecipitation was done for TRAF6, and immunoblotting was performed to examine the other proteins involved in the pathway. So these results showed that TRAF6 interacts with IRS1, P62 as well as AKT upon insulin stimulation. The interaction of TRAF6 with IRS1 is dependent upon the presence of P62, because wherever antisense P62 is transfected, there is a significant impairment in the interaction between TRAF6 and IRS1. On the other hand, there is no significant or detectable reduction in the interaction between TRAF6 and AKT even upon the transfection of the antisense P62 construct. Thus, these results confirm that the interaction of TRAF6 with IRS1 is dependent upon P62, but the interaction of TRAF6 with AKT is independent of the presence of P62. So these again confirm our studies that P62 is present in between IRS1 and TRAF6, while TRAF6 does not require the presence of P62 to interact with AKT. Now that we have placed P62 in the picture, we wanted to confirm the same results with a totally different cell model. And instead of just using the transfection experiments, here we have used wild type and P62 knockout mouse embryonic fibroblast cells. So after stimulating the cells with or without insulin, immunoprecipitation was performed for TRAF6, and immunoblotting was performed to understand all the other protein expressions. So these results confirm that TRAF6 interacted with IRS1, P62 as well as AKT upon insulin stimulation in the wild type mouse embryonic fibroblast cells. Looking into this blood, TRAF6, the interaction of TRAF6 with IRS1 is significantly impaired upon the P62 knockout in these MEF cells. On the other hand, the interaction of TRPC6 with AKT is still significantly present even in the P62 knockout upon the reduction of the P62 levels in these cells. So these results confirm the previous experiment that the interaction of TRPC6 with IRS1 is dependent upon the presence of P62, while the interaction of TRPC6 with AKT is independent upon the presence of P62. Thus, IRS1 and TRPC6 have P62 in between them, while the interaction of AKT with TRPC6 is independent upon the presence of P62. So now that we know which protein is in between what other two proteins, we wanted to stress upon the overall goal of our project, which was to confirm that P62-TRPC6 complex is the connecting link or the bridge to connect IRS1 with AKT. For this, we combined the use of all our knockout models which we had, both the P62 knockout as well as the TRPC6 knockout mouse embryonic fibroblast cells, along with the wild type mouse embryonic fibroblast cells. So after stimulating it with or without insulin, immunoprecipitation was performed for IRS1, and to examine all the other proteins, immunoblotting was done for IRS1, P62, TRPC6 as well as AKT antibodies. So these results showed that IRS1 interacts with P62, TRPC6 as well as AKT in the wild type mouse embryonic fibroblast cells upon insulin stimulation. Further, the interaction of IRS1 with TRPC6 is dependent upon the presence of P62. This is because there is a significant reduction or almost an absence of any interaction between IRS1 and TRPC6 in the P62 knockouts. On the other hand, the interaction of IRS1 with AKT was significantly impaired, not just in the P62 knockouts, but also upon the reduction of TRPC6 levels through TRPC6 knockout MEV cells. Thus, these results confirm that the interaction of IRS1 with AKT is dependent upon both P62 as well as TRPC6. Thus, these again confirm that IRS1 interacts with TRPC6 only upon the presence of P62, first point, and then the interaction of IRS1 with AKT not only required P62 but also TRPC6. In other words, both these proteins as a complex are necessary for the activation of AKT and its phosphorylation. So now that we have understood that P62 and TRPC6 are indeed the linking connection between IRS1 and AKT, we used phosphorylation experiments to confirm that AKT is activated only through these two proteins. So the crude lysates were loaded as the input, and wild type P62 knockout and TRPC6 knockout mouse embryonic fibroblast cells were used with or without insulin stimulation. Immunoblotting was performed using the phosphorylated AKT antibodies to detect the threonine-308 residue and the serine-473 residues. So it's been already demonstrated that the phosphorylation of AKT in these two residues by PDK1 is what is essential for the activation of AKT. So, and also the total AKT levels expressions in these cells were also examined as a control. So these results indicated that the phosphorylation of AKT in both the threonine as well as the serine residue required the presence of P62 as well as TRPC6. Whenever the expression of P62 and TRPC6 is reduced, as in the case of these P62 knockout and the TRAF6 knockout mouse embryonic fibroblast cells, there is a significant impairment in the expression and the phosphorylation of the AKT protein. Thus, this result confirms that P62 and TRAF6 serve as a bridge for AKT phosphorylation, leading to its activation, thus affecting its role on GLUT4 translocation as well as glucose uptake. In other words, P62 and TRAF6 are both essential for the activation of AKT. So just concluding whatever we've done so far together, TRAF6 interacts with IRS1 as well as AKT upon insulin stimulation. P62 interacts with all the other three proteins, IRS1, TRAF6, and also AKT upon insulin stimulation. TRAF6 serves as a link to connect P62 with AKT, and P62 is present in between IRS1 and TRAF6. So the interaction of TRAF6 with IRS1 is dependent upon P62, but the interaction of TRAF6 with AKT does not require the presence of P62. And the last is to confirm that P62 and TRAF6 are indeed essential to phosphorylate AKT and thus leading to its activation. So to give a summary, our findings have confirmed that IRS1, P62, TRAF6 and AKT are present as a complex in the entire insulin signaling pathway. P62 and TRAF6 serve as a bridge to connect IRS1 with AKT. Any aberration or any defects in these vital molecular as components of the insulin signaling pathways could lead to insulin resistance, thus contributing to the development of type 2 diabetes. So through this research, we hope to aid future diabetes research in targeting these proteins and by also in examining them and confirming that these are indeed a part of the insulin signaling pathway. So I would like to thank my advisor, Dr. Jagannathan, for being so kind and really supportive all along my 2 years here. I want to thank Dr. Singh for being a great source of inspiration, and he's been guiding me right from the time I was here. Dr. Huggins for being so friendly and responding to all my questions and being so approachable. So I want to thank you all for serving in my committee and for guiding me in the right direction to make this project possible. This entire study would not have been possible without the help and the assistance of Dr. Geeta. She helped me at whatever point of time I approached her. She's been really supportive. Thank you, Dr. Geeta. And of course, Chen and Shraddha have been wonderful lab mates. They have helped me in so many different ways. I would also like to acknowledge Dr. Inouye and Dr. Ishii from the University of Tokyo and the University of Tsukuba, Japan, for providing us with the wild-type P62 knockout and the TRAF6 knockout mouse embryonic fibroblast cells. I would also like to acknowledge Dr. Musket for providing us with different constructs, including the P62 constructs. And thanks to all the undergrad students, Marina, Sandhya, Katie, Raylan, Salome, and our new master's student, John, for all making the lab so much more cheerful and a happy place to work. Thank you, Gauri, Guang, and Meng, and Aruru, all of you, for being such wonderful friends. So thank you all again, and I would like to respond to your questions.
Outstanding presentation, phenomenal work for a master's student. It is, you've done a great amount of work trying to show that this interaction between P62 and TRAF6 with IRS1 and then the link to AKT. I got lost halfway through in the sense that with so many of these Western blocks, what I want to emphasize was that you have looked at every angle of it, every possible angle, trying to prove your hypotheses in terms of how these molecules interact, and looking at epitope tag versions in mouse embryonic fibroblasts, these P62 knockouts and TRAF6 knockouts. I think it's a very interesting work. I think it's going to contribute significantly to the field of insulin signaling. And congratulations on the presentation. Congratulations on your research. Are you thinking of publishing it somewhere? I'm sure you are.
Yes, at this point.
I have a couple of questions which maybe you could answer so all of us can understand this better. And I just want to understand about these two proteins, P62 and TRAF6. In terms of A, where is this expressed? B, is it differentially expressed in obesity and diabetes or insulin-resistant conditions? Do you have, at the gene expression level and also the protein level, do you find alterations in insulin-resistant obesity, diabetes? And the third question, again, in relation to this, would be to give us a sort of a take-home message. I know you were discussing these two proteins in terms of insulin signaling pathways and looking at phosphorylation status of AKT. So your AKT seems to be the representative molecule which seems to be the link to insulin signaling. So in other words, I would like to know, do these TRAF6 or the P62 null mice or heterozygous mice, do they have a diabetic phenotype? So in other words, I'm trying to find out, are these molecules altered in diabetic conditions, physiologically relevant situations? You know, one thing that we all understand is when you overexpress or you look at individual signaling molecules, they play a role. But does the phenotype of these heterozygous or null mice, do they represent diabetes or a glucose intolerance or insulin resistance? So give us the big picture at the end. I want to look and know about the expression levels first, and then how through these interactions, how, I know you focus on AKT, we have not looked at glucose uptake or other markers that are endpoints of insulin action. And so I want to know what those phenotype of those molecules, null mice, would be.
Okay. So my understanding is that P62, because it's a shuttling protein and a scaffolding protein, it's able to move across different cellular components, that thus shuttling the other proteins from the cytoplasm going to the mitochondria and moving them for degradation. So P62, I think it's a shuttling protein, so it can move across different cellular components. And P62 knockout mice have shown the phenotype of mature onset obesity. They are obese, and they do have, I'm not sure how long, but insulin resistance and leptin resistance has indeed contributed to the development of type 2 diabetes in these mice. And TRAF6 knockout have been shown to be lethal, because TRAF6 is not just involved in this particular process, but as I mentioned before, it has so many other roles, right, from tumorigenesis, inflammation, and it's so crucial in both innate as well as adaptive immunity. So right about 2 to 4 weeks after knocking out a mice devoid of TRAF6, it's going to be lethal for the mice.
Expression levels, what kind of cells, what tissues are these expressed more or less, or are there differences?
Okay. I would guess that in skeletal muscle cells and the liver, where insulin is more active, the P62 and TRAF6 expressions might be more, but I'm pretty sure they are present in almost all the cell tissue types.
Generally, if you see, as she mentioned, it's all over the place, but not found any specific cell line. But if you look for, we have data, she will present today, if you look for obese people, the level of P63 is reduced. If you look for diabetes people, the level of P63 is reduced in skeletal muscle. So we don't look for other regions. Those conditions, even the TROP6 as well. The TROP6 level also reduced in obese, separate group, and diabetes, both groups.
So that's what I was trying to figure out. So you have reductions in obesity for both P62 and TROP6.
Yeah, and also one more thing.
Both in animal models and in humans?
In human skeletal muscle, I have data that the level of P62 and TROP6 is significantly reduced. And with the mouse model, when you knock out P62, in 12 weeks, you can start to get a phenotype. It's also Alzheimer's disease phenotype. The mouse develops Alzheimer's disease phenotype, then obesity, type 2 diabetes, all the phenotype. With heterozygotes, we try it with the mouse model. But heterozygotes, it's getting late, but you do get a phenotype. And there is a paper recently, one of our collaborators.
For P62 heterozygote.
Yeah, yes. Okay. One of the collaborators, Dr. Masker, he recently published a paper in JCI. There is 12 different knockout, different region. The knockout is in different region shows that which is specifically important for diabetes and obesity. But with the TROP6, again, as you said, when you knock out, you don't get the mice because it's lethal. So that's what we use mostly, MAPS. Otherwise, it would be nice to use skeletal muscle to show this study. But it is just really lethal. Thank you.
So in your kind of classical insulin second messenger system, you have PI3 kinase connecting IRS1 to AKT. And I think you did a really good job showing P62 and TRAF, but that kind of begs the question, how do P62 and TRAF, how do you think they interact with PI3 kinase?
I'm not sure if there is a direct interaction, but PI3 kinase is responsible for the conversion of PIP2 to PIP3. That is what is in turn leading to the activation of PDK1, which in turn phosphorylates AKT, and that is leading to the other effects of AKT on the glucose uptake as well as good for translocation. So we've not looked into the interaction of P62 or AKT with many other proteins, including PI3 kinase. So not sure if how the interactions would be or there is any other player involved to regulate the process.
Ask a follow-up to that? Okay, so if you have to design an experiment to look at the role of PI3 kinase in these pathways, how would you go about designing an experiment?
Okay, we would do an immunoprecipitation for one of the proteins, say P62, and do an immunoblotting with the protein with which we want to see the interaction. So immunoprecipitation would probably be P62 or PI3 kinase, and the immunoblotting would be for the other one, P62 or the PI3 kinase. So to understand if those are interacting, and by stimulating the cells with or without insulin, we can see the expression and if there is an interaction between these two proteins.
Yeah, that's the interaction. Mm-hmm. But from your studies, you definitely show that insulin is the key. So which means it's a series of phosphorylations which are key, and which means you would need to know if activation of PI3 kinase is important in the IRS1, TRAF6, P62, all of these interactions. So is the activation of PI3 kinase important? So if you have to find out, may not be direct interaction.
Phosphorylation.
So is the activation of PI3 kinase important in this pathway? So then, what would you do?
Yeah, I think I need something. can you do a phosphorylation experiment, and we could use P62 knockout and see if PI3 kinase is still getting phosphorylated upon insulin stimulation. And by knocking out different other proteins, these four proteins in this complex, and upon insulin stimulating it, understanding if the particular residues where phosphorylation of PI3 kinase is important to lead to its activation, we would probably...
I'm just quizzing you, okay? So P62 is downstream of IRS1. So if you take P62 null mice, it really doesn't help because PI3 kinase is upstream.
Yeah,
so
yeah. Oh, IRS1.
Yeah, so you cannot use null mice, P62, you can't use those.
Okay, maybe antisense IRS1 to reduce the expression of... IRS1.
PI3 kinase is still upstream.
Yeah.
So,
okay.
What would you do? Can you use inhibitors, PI3 kinase, PI3K inhibitors?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you can use antisense, and you know, all that is the next step.
Uh-huh.
The easiest way would be to simply do
use an
LY compound, or you know, something that would inhibit, what manner would inhibit PI3 kinase. And then you inhibit insulin action at that point, then it doesn't go any further down. So if you inhibit with Wortmannin, there is no glucose uptake, there is no AKT activation, you don't see any of those. So if you use Wortmannin or that LY compound, then your hypothesis would be that you would not see any interaction with P62 and IR because you're blunting out or negating the effects of insulin basically at that point. That would give you an idea if PI3 kinase is important or not. And all of insulin action, I mean, it seems to be so dependent on that PI3 kinase activity.
Mm-hmm.
Any questions? Come on, graduate students, don't help each other. Okay, thank you. Thank you for coming. Please help yourself.
Thank you, thank you.
For graduates.